It gives me great pleasure. Like Alessandro was saying, I'm in the computer science department, and I run the Columbia Machine Learning Lab, and I'm very excited to be able to talk to you today about some of the new and really unusual socially impacting things we're doing. And one of the most interesting things we've been working on is GPS data, and what we'll be talking about today is how we can extract information from GPS. But before we do that, let's just take a time trip back maybe 10 years ago to what was the emerging new paradigm in, I would say, computer science and in many other fields, and that was the World Wide Web. And what happened there was we started to think about information not in terms of text files and images, but in terms of networks. And that was a revolution in the way our understanding of large systems changed. And at some point, we stopped thinking about internet places as a document or a list of words or a list of images, but really as a network of many documents and a network of online places. And that was a very powerful analogy, this networks analogy. And we've also recently seen in the past, I would say, 4 years or so, another network, which is a network of people also online. And that's the Facebook network and the MySpace network and so on. And both of these phenomena have been wonderful because they've allowed us to, again, explore this concept of a network online in terms of a network of places and a network of people. So what I'm here to talk to you about next is how do we move these networks, which are beautiful networks of places and beautiful networks of people, out of the online world and into the real world that we care about and we function in every day. And so how do we make a network of real places, not a network of websites and virtual places? How do we make a network of real people, not just our online personas, if you will? And so one of the problems with doing this is we haven't had too much data from the real world. We've had a lot of data from the online world. It's easier to get that data. It's all organized for us. So how do we get data from the real world? And a funny little phenomenon has been creeping in and letting us do this recently, and that's called GPS. And so many of you have cell phones or personal navigation devices or one of these new iPhones, or even if you've taken a taxi to come down here tonight, you were actually generating GPS data or more generally location data, which said where you were roughly, either using the satellites in outer space or using the towers right here on the ground and doing some tower triangulation. So we all generate location information. So that's a new way of measuring what we're doing and what is happening in places that hopefully will let us build a network of real places and a network of real people. Okay, so I'll talk about that in just a second. And a lot of this work is being done with the collaboration of Sense Networks, which is a company that I helped found in 2006, which has been collecting this data from many different sources. And I'll talk about the interesting things we can do with the data. But before that, since this is an engineering crowd, I'm going to talk about some of the tools we've been using and do a little bit of showing off about the algorithms, since I'm a computer science person. And one of the algorithms that we're pretty excited about is a technique for actually visualizing a network. There's a giant network out there. How do we make these pretty pictures of it just to see it? And we have an algorithm called the minimum volume embedding algorithm. Embedding is just a fancy word for visualization. And in 2007, Blake Shaw and I showed how you can basically say, here's a network. I don't want to squeeze or stretch any of the edges in the network. Those have to stay the same length. But I can move around the nodes. And I want to visualize it. And I like to visualize things in 2D. Or maybe 3D maximum. So how do I go from this 3D thing to something I like to visualize, which is a 2D thing? And we wrote an algorithm that basically says you can move the nodes around, but don't stretch the edges. And try to lay this network out in 2D. In other words, from this matrix E, which describes the connectivity here, find another matrix K, which has the same connectivity, but is only two-dimensional. And then we can actually take a look at this thing in 2D. So this is the minimum volume embedding algorithm. And that's one tool that we're going to be using with our networks, which lets us just look at them and visualize them. And here's roughly how it works. We start off with a 3D network, and we solve this program called the semi-definite program. And it squashes the network into 2D, so we can actually see it in 2D by unwrapping and moving the nodes. And all the edges stay fixed. They're like little metal links between the edges. They can't squeeze or stretch. And as you do this, the algorithm solves and gives you back this picture on the right and says, here's a 2D version of this 3D network. And so what we're solving is we're basically finding another matrix. Instead of this matrix E, we find a matrix K, which is two-dimensional. Basically, the stretchiness in the top dimension and the second dimension is really large compared to the total stretchiness on all the other dimensions, where lambda is the stretchiness of each dimension. So if that's 100%, that means this is a 100% 2D network. So we run this to visualize networks. And here, for example, is one of the networks like we were showing before. This is visualizing some of the websites that many of you browse. And we're visualizing them again in 2D. This is actually much higher than 2D. We've been able to squash it down into 2D. And this is the, I think, top 500 websites on the internet. And we're using the AOL data to calculate the network. We figured out the network from the AOL data set and laid it out for you. And some interesting things pop up. So for example, over here, we've got all the airlines popping up next to each other. We've got UnitedAirlines.com, AmericanAirlines.com, Orbitz.com being laid out close to each other from the AOL data. So we can at least visualize the network. Another thing we like to do with networks is break them into smaller pieces. And that's called clustering. And one thing we'd like to do is find the weakest links in this network and just cut it up with a pair of scissors and say, here are two large clusters. And then maybe these clusters might be, let's say, certain types of websites, and these are other types of websites, and we split them into two categories. And so we have another algorithm, just like the MVE algorithm for visualizing networks. We also have an algorithm for breaking it into pieces or color coding it. Yeah?
Could you explain briefly the dimensions of a network, what that actually means?
So the dimension of a network basically says, how many dimensions do I need to visualize all the pairwise dependencies between all the nodes? And if you have enough dimensions, then you can visualize every point, and every point's distance to every other point remains fixed. But if you only have 2D distances, you basically have to lose something. It's almost like when you take, look at the network of cities on the planet. That's a 3D network. We've got Tokyo, Paris, London, New York. That's a 3D network, but when you look at a map on a piece of paper, you see a 2D version of it. So you've gone from a 3D network to a 2D network, hopefully without losing too much. And you do lose a little bit because Greenland looks like it's twice as big as it should be and things like this. So the basic thing we do when we do the cartography of going from 3D to 2D is what this algorithm is doing, but it's going from a much higher dimensional space, which is the internet and the many, many places on it, to a 2D representation. That's a good question. So, and then similarly, we're going to color code, let's say, two pieces. Hopefully, if this was, again, the cities analogy, maybe Europe and North America would be split into two separate networks. So we have another algorithm. And again, just to show off that we still know how to use Greek symbols and we're still engineers. We're not just talking about social science here. Clustering network turns out in computer science to be a very difficult problem. Even though it looks intuitively easy, if I give you a network and I say cut it into two pieces or a few pieces, finding the optimal solution, phi star, is NP hard. And so in computer science, NP just means it's going to take exponential amounts of time or exponential numbers of computation. So we're going to compute things, let's say, for these 6 points and some number that grows exponentially. So that's not so bad for 6 points. But if you have a million nodes, then you're talking about the lifetime of the universe to just perfectly cut the network into two. But again, we solve this problem approximately, because getting it exactly would be a really mind-boggling result, which would change computer science as we know it. But we get an approximate solution, again using this technique called semi-definite programming and another tool called B-matching. And we guarantee that we can actually split the network with something that's not much worse than the optimal answer, so with this algorithm. So again, this is just basically some fancy math to say we're not doing too badly when we cut the network into two pieces or into a few pieces. OK, so we've got these two tools. And what we're going to be doing is applying these things to real data, not the online networks. And we're going to work with GPS data. And that's because we care about the real world. We kind of forgot about it in the past decade, but it makes a big difference. And basically, GPS data is now being gathered by vehicles. So all the taxis in New York, that's about 17,000 taxis, report their location every 10 minutes or so to headquarters with a GPS ping, we like to call it. If you use one of these applications to find interesting restaurants or to find your friends if they want to report their location on an iPhone, again, you're generating location data. And we know from this data where you are and at what time you were there. If you use one of these devices that helps you with traffic, there's data being collected also. When you drive around with your car, your information is being used to figure out how slow traffic is on the road that you're driving on right now. And of course, if you have a cell phone, whenever you use your phone to make a call or send a text, the phone company knows which cell towers you're using and how close you are to each one. So they know roughly where you are. And what Sense Networks does is it basically takes a lot of this data through various agreements from different companies and analyzes it. And I'll be talking about some of the analysis we're using, the analysis tools, and one of the fun applications we've released called CitySense, and how we're basically building networks of real places and networks of people from real data, not just your online data. And why is this interesting? Well, all the interesting things you can do with online networks and the stuff you can do on Facebook, you can now do with your real world activity. So what does that really mean? We can start talking about things like collaborative filtering. When you buy a book on Amazon.com, it says, here are other people who've also bought this book, and here are five other books that they also enjoyed. So maybe you might also enjoy these books. So things like that you can do with online information because the data is there. We can now start doing things like that with your location data. If you went to this restaurant, and I also went to it, but I also went to these five other ones, maybe you'll like these other five restaurants because you enjoyed the same restaurant I enjoyed. And all sorts of other things from advertising and marketing and all the fun stuff you could do online, but now using your GPS information. So how do we do this? Well, here's what the data looks like. I'll replay that again because it's not looping. So here's a little movie of some of the GPS data we're getting from all over the country. And each one of these red blobs basically is proportional to the number of people there generating location information. So you quickly start to see an interesting pattern. This is people's morning commute as they wake up and go to work and come back. I think this is just a few hours of the GPS data across the country. So this is what the raw data looks like. And now let's try to build some understanding out of it. And here's one of the levels of understanding that I think is very timely considering how the economy has been doing lately. We looked at when people get into work, if they work in the financial district. So people come to work in the financial district, do they come in earlier or later, depending on what's happening with the Dow Jones? So interesting thing, people started coming very, very early when the Dow Jones was at its all-time high over here. And then they started coming in much later in the day when the Dow Jones broke its one-year low. But then they realized, I guess panic set in, and they started to come in earlier again to work and thinking maybe I should be working a little harder to keep the job. Another time they came in very, very early was right here before the end of the year. Can someone take a guess why? Bonus time, exactly. So you want to impress the boss and you start coming into work early just to say that you're working very, very hard. So these types of trends pop out from the GPS data and they match some of the real things we do in our buying and selling on the stock market. Other types of things we can look at is how do people go out at night and are they enjoying restaurants and bars or are they staying home? And one of the interesting things is, well, definitely at New Year's people like to go out late at night. You can see these peaks over there. Another interesting thing is right before the basic bad news started coming in about the economy, people were going out and enjoying themselves and going to restaurants. And then recently, the city has just been getting quieter and quieter. And this is San Francisco we're looking at in particular. Now people just aren't going out as much and aren't doing as many things. Okay, so we're getting this data and we can start understanding real behavior from it. And we also wanted to give people the ability to look at this data for themselves so that you don't just have to be a client or an analytics company, but you can just use this on your own phone. So we created this application called CitySense, which just shows you a map, just like your Google map on your regular phone, but it also overlays that red blotchiness we saw earlier, so you know where the people are right now. And so this is real time, and the more red an area is, the more people are there. And I'll show you what I mean on my iPhone here. I'll start it up and we can pass it around. I think it's going to take a second to load. And please return it to me after it goes around the room. So, but the basic idea is you basically get to see where everyone is right now, and you can search for restaurants and organize them in order of the ones that have the most people at them right now. So if you want to go somewhere that's lively, or not lively, if you want somewhere quiet, then you can go to the not so reddish spots. So I'll just pass this around, and if it goes to sleep, just push the button on the bottom. And so this is available for BlackBerry phones, for iPhones, for Nokia phones, and these things just fit in the palm of your hand. And you might be wondering, just that's how big they are. What that ring is on the finger, that's the Japanese version. It fits on your ring. Just joking. This doesn't really exist. So these three are available. You can use it on any one of these three phones. You just need to point your browser to CitySense, www.citysense.com, and download it. Okay, and it's completely free. And what we do is we just show you the most active bars and restaurants right now. Of course, it's not completely free because you have to accept that we'll get your data as well when you let us use this thing. So there's a catch. But you can always delete your own data. If you want to remove your data from the system, that's fine as well. Okay, so that's what we're showing. We're showing where everybody is right now. A slightly more ambitious thing to do is not to show where everybody is, but the first thing people ask me is, well, I'm not interested where everyone is right now. I'm interested in where the people like me are. Okay, my family wants to go to dinner, and I'm looking for a family-style place where there's lots of family-style people. So let me just click on this and show you what the next version of the application will look like, and hopefully this will just start playing. I'll just restart it here. Okay, so in a second we'll just see, and this is not available for download yet, but this is running on our offices right now. In a second we'll start showing you people running around the city, and we've color-coded them. And so the bluish spots are, I think, the younger crowd, the reddish spots are more of the family crowd, these greenish spots are the business crowd that works in the financial district, and so on. And so we've clustered the people, so it's not just a red heat map and everybody just looks like a red dot, but now we've got 8 different colors. And this is not telling you who is whom, you just get to see how many blue people are there, how many red people are there. And yeah?
Why did you do San Francisco rather than New York?
Good question. We did San Francisco first because San Francisco had more data. But now New York is edging San Francisco out, and now we have New York coming online in the next couple of months because we've got a lot more taxis and a lot more people and a lot more GPS. But 3 years ago, San Francisco was more online. Yes?
2 quick questions. How are you identifying the people? How are you identifying the green person, the red person? And what are you doing it for traffic?
Oh, so traffic is a wonderful question. And actually, there's a company out there that's a spin-off from Microsoft called Inrix, which has been doing great traffic modeling. And we didn't want to go head-to-head with Microsoft. But I will tell you what we're doing to identify the people, but it's basically we built a network and we chopped it up into 8 different chunks. And so I'll show you how we built a network of people in just a second to get these 8 different categories. Yeah?
How do you know when a business person
is? So that's a good question. Sometimes, so the color codes changed during the time of day. So you might be a blue person from 9 to 5, and then you might be a green person from 5 to 10.
How do you evaluate?
We build a network that's changing in time, it's not a static network. And I'll show you what I mean in just a second. But that's a very interesting point. Yeah.
Time can't be the only variable in your analysis.
It's not the only variable. So every hour of the week, we treat differently. And in the end, what we'll have to do is we model the network of places and the network of people on an hourly basis for the 168 hours of the week. But that's slide number 25 or something. But yeah, these are all the right questions, and we slowly stumbled on these things as we tried all this stuff. So it was a slow learning procedure, but we finally started to understand some of this data. So this is what we'd like to build. We'd like to build a network of people. And what do I mean by a network of people? Well, there's a link between two people if they're kind of similar. And from there, you can chop the network into pieces and then say, well, these are blue people and these are green people. and put them into categories. So what we'd like to do is build this from all the people using GPS devices. But of course, it's very hard. So here's one of the users in our system. We've got about, right now, we've got 100,000 or so users. We're getting more from some agreements with other partnerships. But here's two users out of our database. So here's user A and here's user B. And they both live in San Francisco. That's home. But this person goes and works in Palo Alto every day and then comes back home. Now this user over here stays in San Francisco for work, doesn't go to Palo Alto. But it turns out both of these guys are working in a technology company. So they both live in the same neighborhood, and they kind of work in the same place. So we can't just look at the raw GPS and say, compare this person to this person just from the GPS. That's not going to get us very far, because it looks really different. But it turns out we've got to change this GPS data into meaningful information about the places you're spending time in. So we need really a network of places. We have to understand what the places are and what they mean before we start saying, well, you spent a lot of time in Palo Alto. Well, what does it mean, Palo Alto? It means high tech and a lot of businesses here that are doing either software or hardware, et cetera. And so we're going to build a network of places and then build a network of people from real data. And what does a network of places look like? Well, it's a little like the network of websites out there on the net. Places that are similar should link to each other. Okay, and when you go to a professor's website, they'll link to other professors. And if you go to some lawyer's website, they might link to other colleagues in the law firm working on similar types of cases. And so people link to each other if they're doing similar things, and websites link to each other if they're doing similar things. And places should be linked together if they have similar activity there. Okay, so we're going to build a network of places. And it's a little tricky, but we're going to describe this network of places by looking at the flow of people in and out of the places, and the commercial activity at the places, and the demographic activity. But by far the one that I like the best is the flow one, because it's a little bit the way Google decided to model the internet. They said, well, look at how people move around on the internet and use that to calculate this thing called a page rank. And by looking at the flow on the internet. So let's look at the flow in the real world. Here's San Francisco, and we're going to look at the flow of people from every place to every other place. And here we're looking at just 200 places so that it doesn't look like too much spaghetti. But we're going to look at the flow from A to B, and for all possible places. How do people move around from A to B to C and so on? That's the network. We just watch people running around the city. And we build this thing called a Markov transition matrix. And this is basically a big network or graph. And then we run this MVE algorithm on it to unfold it and present it in 2D. So here's how this works. We look at people running around between all the pairs of places. Here are the top 200 spots in the city.
Based on flow.
And this is the network. And now we're going to run that same algorithm we ran earlier, which is unfolding the network and putting places that have similar inflow and outflow close by. So if, question.
I'm sorry. I'm just all of this is predicated on getting personal information from the users. And I'm curious what personal information has to be supplied. You're saying, you know, gee, this person's this at this hour and this at that hour. Well, the only way you would know that is if the person said, yeah, I'm a financial profession from this hour to that hour. I mean, what kind of information are you requiring for the users to participate in this experiment that you're doing?
So, very good question. It turns out for this, you don't need any identifiable information about the users. All you need to know is somebody went from here to here, and then forget about who that person was. Or you need to know a taxi went from here to here. And so a lot of this information comes just by looking at taxis and just say, how many people took a cab from here to here?
It's quantified but not qualified information.
It's all quantitative information. We haven't labeled it in any way yet. We're just looking at the flow. So without knowing anything about the people, we're just calculating how many people would go from here to here. That doesn't tell you anything. The people don't have to volunteer any information. You just have to get somebody to say, went from here to here with their phone, or a taxi that went from here to here with a metered fare. Yeah?
I'm assuming that we all have cell phones. Most people have, a lot of people have cell phones with GPS units built into them.
Yeah.
Am I transmitting right now my location?
So that's a great question. You're transmitting your location, but we don't have it. We only have the location of about 100,000 users who have volunteered to use our system. But your cell phone company has your information.
And that's off the cell phone towers or off of actual the GPS location being transmitted back to 18th or whatever.
So they might have your information from the towers. They might have the information also because they grab the GPS data as well. And if you use Maps and you bring up Google's map, they also have your GPS information. That's how they know how to center you on their map. So the data is out there. And again, people have to be careful how they use it, just like the phone company will not send everybody your call logs and put them on the web for free. They're also careful about this data. And we're also very careful of how we use the data from our users.
What was sort of the administrative process that you went through in order to actually gather the data and get permission from each individual person to establish all those nodes?
So we have two applications, the CitySense application. And when you use that, we get, every time you open it up, it sends us a message. And that's part of the agreement when you use it. You can also say, I'm not interested in doing this anymore, delete all my data. We also have a Friend Finder application, which says, show my friends where I am. And we get that data as well, but we never reveal it. We just do analysis on it. So those are how we get the bulk of our user data. And we also get all the taxi data from several cities, New York, San Francisco, Chicago, Houston, and a couple of other smaller cities like Alexandria and so on. So the taxi information doesn't reveal anything about anybody. And then the 100,000 users, we got permission from them. OK, so again, what happened here was we just looked at who went from here to here and how many times did that happen, and then said, well, let's say I'm an Italian restaurant and across the street there's another Italian restaurant. If everybody comes from the same place to eat at our restaurants at the same hour and then they go back home to the same neighborhoods, that means we might be similar types of places. And that's the basic idea here. We moved places nearby if the same inflow and outflow statistics match with those places. And after you've moved them that way, you can go out and color code and cluster this and say, well, these are bluish places, these are reddish places, these are greenish places, and so on. And you've clustered the network as well as visualized it. So we've got a network of places just by watching how people flow. And it's a little like Google's network, which basically looks at how people flow around the internet and where do you go from one website to another. Question?
The accuracy of the information that's flow from a probabilistic point of view is how good?
So the accuracy is a very interesting question because sometimes we have tremendously good accuracy. GPS can be accurate down to about 10 or so feet. In noisy situations, like in this city where there's a lot of skyscrapers, you have a lot of errors and you might have to, let's say, drop down to tower triangulation, which gives you about a couple of hundred feet of accuracy.
But what if you had other people using the same flow but they were not on your system from that point?
Oh, if there's other people we're not able to observe. So that's a good point. And in fact, we were worried about that because we didn't want to just look at the data from people who are tech savvy and had iPhones and had this type of data. So what we've done is we recalibrated the data from our users to match the GPS data from the taxis. And so we know how people move around in the taxis. We normalized it. Very good point. Because taxis are more typical of everybody's behavior than our 100,000 users. And so that it's not all just based on flow, we also actually look at each place and look at what commercial activity is available in this one block location. And if you open a business in the United States or in Europe, you have to register your business into one of 10,000 possible categories. Is it a retail, is it a restaurant, is it a Italian restaurant, and so on. So we can get, for every corner in the city, what kind of commercial activity is there from basically this standard industrial categorization code that everybody registers their business under. So that also tells us information about the places. Think of this like the web page content on the internet. And then, in addition, there's a lot of public data available on demographics. So you can also know something about, well, what's the average income in this neighborhood, and how much do people spend, and what's the population density? So these are three types of data, the flow, the commerce there, and the population demographics. And this gives us our network of places. And then we look at the network of people by saying, which places do you hang out in? And so we've already split the network of places into different clusters, about 20 or so clusters for the flow characteristics, 97 clusters for the commercial activity, and 78 clusters of demographic activity. And then for every hour of your week, and this relates back to your question, we look at which cluster do you spend your time in? What kind of commercial activity do you like to do at week hour number 2? What kind of demographic do you hang out in week hour 168 out of your week? What kind of flow cluster do you hang out in hour 143? And so this is now a single user, and this is one of our 100,000 users or so. These are the red dots are where they've traveled, and we've converted each one of those red dots into one of these different bins in this matrix. And so now we can describe this person, and we can forget about their information. We just know that they like to go to an Italian restaurant on Thursday evenings with 30% probability, or they eat at home with 70% probability. We can also say things like, they live in a very wealthy neighborhood, but they work in a not-so-wealthy neighborhood, because they might be running a factory, and they spend a lot of time at the factory. And we might also say, well, they like to hang around in the blue cluster of flow, which we haven't really figured out what blue means. But this is how we describe each one of our users. And then here's 9 users. And we throw away their data once we get these matrices. And as you can tell, you can't really figure out too much about where the person was from just this information, which is good, because last thing we need is for somebody to say, there's a subpoena, we need to know where this person was on November 5th, 2008. But just as a small warning to everyone, if you use EasyPass, for example, that information is being logged every time you go through bridges, and it's used in court cases ranging from divorces to tax evasion. So it's subpoenaed, but we don't want to have this data subpoenaed. This is all we store about each user. And this is telling you where this person hangs around during their week with a probability. It's not exact. But these are 9 users, and the way we build our user network is by looking at all these matrices and just seeing how much does this matrix overlap with this matrix. If you overlap a lot with someone, then you're similar. This person might live in San Francisco, this person might live in New York, but they both eat at Italian restaurants on the weekends, and they both work in a not so wealthy neighborhood, but go to sleep in a wealthy neighborhood, and et cetera. So for all our users, and we've got 100,000 of them, I'll show you what the network looks like for a piece of it. That's the network. And this is a real world activity network, not your Facebook network where you say, these people are my friends. And so here we figured out your friends by the people who are similar to you, not because you've called them your friends. And you can't really be connected to 1,000 people in this network the way you can be connected to 1,000 people on Facebook. Yeah?
Well, for what period of time do you analyze patterns of behavior?
So for some of our users, we actually have 3 years worth of their data.
Okay.
Other users, we have 3 months worth of their data. But it turns out it quickly settles into a reasonable model of the person after even just a month. You start to say, well, they can't possibly be on this side of the network. They're on this side of the network. And then the interesting applications you can do with this network now is you can, again, separate it into pieces and start doing things like, well, this person likes to buy sports equipment. Maybe these people are interested in buying sports equipment. You can do smart collaborative filtering, advertising, and so on. So again, we talked about the internet and how it let us build networks of virtual places called websites, and networks of people and their virtual personas called Facebook or MySpace. And then now we're talking about networks built from real data and what you're really doing out in the real world versus what you're typing in into a form online. And just a little caveat, this data is a lot more honest, because it turns out half the users of MySpace, or not half, but the most popular zip code declared for users in MySpace is 90210. So here you'd actually have to go and hang out at 90210 every night for you to fall into that zip code. Okay, so again, thank you for your attention. Please ask some more questions now, and if you have a chance, come visit us at Columbia, or visit us not at the real place, but the virtual place at that website. This is joint work with my students, and those are them, but this is a nicer picture outside the lab where we were on a conference. And this is the company's website with my co-founders, Greg, Alex Pentland from MIT, and Christine. So thank you, and please ask some more questions. Thank you. Okay, well, everyone knows my phone numbers now. Yeah?
There was an article in Sunday Times.
Yeah.
That talked about networks, but communication networks, and how teams communicate with each other. Can you add to this the communication network, if allowed, given the permission to be able to sense how strong the communication bond occurs in, let's say, a team work environment?
So that's a great question. And in fact, this data does exist. Companies from your Verizon to your Sprints have this thing called the call graph or the call network. And they know who talks to whom and how much. And they use that for some of their analysis. But it turns out that's even more sensitive information than this type of information. And we've gotten to take little peeks at this data. And it turns out it's very hard to get. There was recently a paper in Nature, which I think the New York Times article pointed to by Laszlo Barabasi, who was a colleague of mine, where they got the call graph from a phone company in Hungary, or in Eastern Europe, I should say. And it's all the calls, and they were able to do analysis there. But that's even more sensitive information. And I don't think that will be as easy to get. And again, you can also, in the future, who knows, analyze what people are saying and things like that. But that's, I think, even more iffy than getting location information, which it turns out 100,000 people don't mind doing right now for this level of analytics. So it's been easy to get this type of information, especially if you give back some value. Yeah?
I'm just curious that you said that a lot of information you get from is from a taxi. But many times the taxi actually are traveling around idling, so it doesn't really, many times do not really represent people, women. How do you feel with that kind of information now?
So that's a great question. It turns out we're not just tracking the taxi, but we know when they have a metered fare and when it started and when it ended. Otherwise, you're right. The taxis are always driving around, sometimes fairly aimlessly, especially in New York. But yeah, we get the meter on, meter off, and so we don't know how many people are in the taxi, but we know somebody's paying for that time. So that's the only information we get from the TLC and the other cities that we were able to get the data from. Yeah. Yep, so if people have more questions, please feel free to come up and talk to me. If you're interested in any of this stuff, I'm happy to give you more pointers. And if you want to download the application, go to this website with any of your mobile phones and download citysense.com. And if you want to delete your data, there's a big button that says delete all my data. And we really believe we have so Alex Pentland from MIT has drafted what he thinks is the data ownership plan for the future, which is we all own our own data. And so if you're using Google or if you're using AOL and you search for things, you should be able to push a button and say delete all my data. Or give my data to Yahoo. I don't want to work with Google anymore. And so we've started this approach, and we think as people become smarter about their data, they know it's more valuable, they should own it. Oh, one other question, yeah.
I'm not sure if this is accurate, but I was told that with Google, even though you tell them to delete the data, they actually keep a copy in some form. I'm not sure if that's accurate.
I heard something similar, but I can't speak about exactly what Google is doing. I think there is some issue like that it's too hard for them to really delete it. So they just, they
but
kind
in your
of,
case, you're able to delete it completely?
We completely delete our data, yeah.
And it's not, you're not able to recreate it in some way? Like you're able to, like when you take the fat off the hard drive, the data so that you actually recreate?
Well, I'd have to check with our engineers, but I don't think it's easy for us to recreate the data once we've deleted it. So we don't want you to delete your data. But again, we have to respect that because our new deal on data is you own your own data. Yes?
How did you select your sample?
Our sample of users?
Yeah.
We took...
No, your 100,000.
Oh, out of the 100,000 for this, 1,000 subset. I think these were some of the more active users. So some of the users have only been around in our system for a few months or a few weeks. Some of them have been around for 3 years. These are our more active users that have been around for longer. Not active in terms of they do more, but they've been with us longer. So these are our most long-term users out of the 100,000 or so.
What's the application for the information from business marketing?
So we're looking at all these different five applications. Marketing is very important. If you are Pepsi and you want to show an ad on the phone to only the young and edgy people because you're going to show some rock and roll musician drinking Pepsi, you don't want to show it to all these people. You want to show it to these people. So now you can do something like that, where you can say, just show it to this part of the network.
Yes.
Is your data time weighted?
Yes. So a lot of this, the actual hour of the week matters, and the more recent activity affects the model more than the past activity. So if you, for example, change your habits, the model will adapt and won't stay stuck at where it was 3 years. That's a very interesting question. It's an exponential decay type of weighting. Okay, so yeah, I might be over time. So thank you very much, everyone.